Welcome to my talk. My name is Daniel. I'm a freelance consultant living here in Bonn. And I had the motivation to invent a tool which helps in application landscape management. And let's start. I think you all have all read the introductional text in the program. So my first question would be to you: what do you expect from this talk? I will repeat the questions here for the streaming. My motivation was, as you have seen in the comic, that they're often in projects. There are several things not really working well. One of them is often project documentation. It's neither up to date nor existing. So why are you here? Do you have any expectations, or do you have any tools maybe you use? Yes, please. Ah, okay. Yeah. Yeah, thank you. So,
most companies I work with don't know anything.
Yeah.
Enterprise
architecture. Yeah. So next time we'll try the micro. Can you help me with that? So the question does work. Hello. Okay. Next time. So the question was if this talk is about LeanIX or which tools I will present. In fact, I have worked for LeanIX some years ago, and I really like what they are doing. They're developing professional enterprise architecture management tools. And the project I'm in, they often lack resources for such tools. I will show later why. Usually, you don't have a full-time architect, or you don't have the resources to pay such a professional tool. So I went on and had a look into the open source market to see what is already present there. There are some really nice solutions. Some of them I will name, but neither of them really satisfied me. So I went on and tried to improve one of those tools. Any other comments? Okay. So you may have seen the comic on the title slide. I think that's still true for most of the projects. And the points where I want to improve the situation is, what's concerning my tool is often analysts design an application landscape, a bunch of microservices or whatever, and the design is not really that what is implemented later on, or what maybe operation installs. Architects don't necessarily know all that constrictions that ops have, and often the can you see it? Yeah. Often the project is rarely documented, or the documentation is completely missing. I'm often in the situation to be the new guy in the project, and I have to go around and ask everybody, what is this service doing? Why is it there? Why was it built like that? Are there any architectural limitations or something? And usually the guy who built this isn't in the project anymore, or nobody can answer it. This is, at least for me, these are typical situations. And of course, I want to build a competing open source version or to professional tools. What is application landscape management? The definition is quite long. I can't remember it right now. I Googled it today, but it was really too long to paste it here. What you can do is to identify weaknesses in your whole application landscape, all the services in your landscape, all the machines maybe, or gateways, proxies, whatever there is. They need to be documented. And if you have the full image of what is happening in your landscape, then you maybe can identify weaknesses or find opportunities to improve something. Otherwise, your knowledge is limited and you might not see some restrictions or so. So that is why landscape management is important. And nowadays, you often build microservices. Yeah, everybody here, I think, does microservices because they are fancy. And suddenly, you have more and more deployments and more communication. And it's hard to remember all that. The whole system, the whole landscape gets a lot more complicated. So that is why it's important to document it. Application landscape management is first of all about services. So services are anything you can deploy that has some business value or does something on a technical level that enables other services to do something, to deliver the business value. But application landscape management is also about networks, about data flow, that is which service communicates to others. Can he do so? Are there any networks in between? Or what about security? What about costs, business capability, and so on? The list here isn't complete, but I think you can get the idea. These are typical questions an architect has to deal with. But I think it's also equally important for developers to know all these things, because ultimately the developers have to implement what the business side wants, and they have to know things like life cycle. When does the service I need goes out of business, or is the service I need maybe not healthy enough to contact it every day, or if I need a new feature from another service that I'm dependent on, I have to ask the owner. And who is the business owner of that service? And does he have the money to implement that feature? These are important questions. So what can you do to do ALM? First of all, I've made up this chart. It isn't really scientific. I just made it up. On the basic level, you can do handmade art. That is, you use a tool like a pencil, or there's also a tool called Pencil, which is actually really, really nice for drawing. Or you can use OmniGraffle on Macs, or you can use Microsoft Office, Visio, these tools. There's Draw.io, which is really it's a really cool tool, and they're using a library I'm using too. But and there's wikis, of course, but all these documentation you're entering is outdated in the moment you are entering it, because it's not totally not automated. It depends on what you know. And you can imagine that after 2 or 4 weeks, it's completely the opposite of what's really going on in your landscape. Then you have tools like PlantUML or GraphWiz. GraphWiz is for drawing graphs. You can script them, but it requires a lot more effort. You have to learn these tools, you have to learn these languages, and although they are powerful, you still have to invest some more. And then, of course, there's LinaX, for example, or other enterprise tools, which deliver the most value. These tools are focused at doing exactly that landscape management concerns. They offer a lot of value, but they have two prices. Either they cost in terms of money, or you have to learn some very sophisticated language. They have some models, and this is usually not something a developer has time to do, or an ops guy or so. So what you need is something in between. A tool you can automate, and that will generate most of the documentation for you, so you can answer these questions about whatever helps also automatically and in an easy way. And the tools I found, there are some more. For example, with texture, you have to look it up at GitHub. It seems to be a really cool tool. Uses graphics, so it creates a graph, and I don't know, it uses proprietary input formats to draw your application landscape. You should really check it out, I think. Then there's PVO. PVO is the predecessor, so to say, of my project, which is called Nevio. PVO was invented by some guys from Epost, and I really like their approach. They're using a very basic language, and they use YAML files to describe their landscape. And they use terms which are quite common, but quite well known to all of us blue collar guys. So, but what I didn't like about PVO was it uses some server agent architecture. That means, as far as I understood it, you have to deploy agents on every target system, and that's not something I don't want to have. I want to have a tool which you can run once. And then end, and you have some artifacts like documentation in HTML or PDF or whatever. And then if you need it again, you can run it again. But you don't have to be dependent on agents or anything else. You don't necessarily need access to the production environment. Yeah, this is what Nevio does. It generates graphs. So yeah, I will explain it a bit. So these circles here are systems in my landscape. This whole thing is a landscape, and I have for example here a WordPress running my blog, and I have an Apache in front of it. I have some other microservice I don't know which sends emails, and WordPress also uses a database. It maybe uses a cache. And then if you're in enterprise environments, you have maybe a single sign-on system before it, and yeah, maybe a dashboard measuring KPIs or whatever. So it doesn't really matter what's inside this landscape. What matters here is that this graph is more or less fully automatically layouted. Yeah, genau. So every service here has, for example, interfaces, or it has dependencies here to the cache. Without the cache, it wouldn't run. So it's based on how you model it. You could model it otherwise. It doesn't really matter, but it's up to you to say the cache is mandatory or not. And you have also data flow, for example, which means that the WordPress has been extended by a plugin and now sends JSON to that KPI system here. So all these things you can model. And these services can also have state and a lot more, which I will show now. Yeah. One thing I think I need to mention is that the current version is quite young. So yeah, I had yesterday evening and even this morning I had to fix a lot of bugs, but I think I finally got the demo running. So there's no official release yet. Yeah, but let's see how it works. What I did is it is written in Java, but that doesn't really matter. I have already started an instance. It's running on my computer here at port 8080, and I told Nevio, now, please go and start with a file. And this file here, can you see it? Does anybody know how to enlarge the font size with Microsoft Visual Studio Code? Because I don't. Ah, okay, maybe like that. Okay, so this is a proprietary language used in PVO and a bit modified by me. What does it do? It names an identifier for your language, which is more targeted at systems to exactly define this as the landscape, and perhaps there are other landscapes too. You can give it a human readable name, and you can add contact info and other stuff. And then you have sources. Sources are references from where I can pull information. And this is one important thing of Nevio. it can do push. You can do push information inside Nevio, but what is it? The idea is to use pull. That means Nevio would pull information from ever from whatever source there is. You can use maybe a GitHub repo or here Docker Compose files from other servers, or you can even grab stuff from a GitHub repo. And there are of course other things you could imagine, like having an existing Docker machine and log into that Docker machine and have the services listed, or Kubernetes or whatever there is. There are a lot of fancy stuff right now. Or maybe a monitoring system. All these sources of information could be used here as references. And yeah, for the demo, I've told Nevio to read from this Docker Compose file, which is quite simple. It has you can always interrupt me if you don't know what Docker is, or I have to explain it a bit more than just say it. So yeah, it has three services. There's one web service, there's one Redis, then there's Datadog. I just copied that from the internet. What happens? It reads that that file and displays it. So it says, okay, we have three services, and I'm using the name from the Docker service name. And I know there's maybe a link between Redis and web, and so there's a dependency between them, and that is what it does. So that's not really much. In a Docker Compose file, you can't add that much information to have a good application landscape management info. So you need a lot more data to gain some value from it. And so the idea is, not to just use that one file, but to add another file. Here, Docker Compose Extra, for example. Here, I added just very few info. I'm using an identifier to pick one of the services from the Docker Compose file and give it a name. So when I'm reloading that stuff now, you see here that suddenly the name has changed. And that is the idea. You use existing sources, which are maybe not perfect for doing ALM, and you enhance it with stuff you can easily manage. For example, I could I could put this file into a Git repository or host it on some web server, and then have it automatically drawn into Nevio. So every time I'm asking Nevio to render that graph, I will get that nice image. And I can now enhance it a bit more. There are a lot more attributes. For example, group. I can group services, and they appear in different groups. Or I can add info about service lifecycle. Has a service just been planned, or is it already end of life, and so on. So I'm saving it and hoping that reload works. Yeah, what you see now is that I have added this group here to that one service, and now it's displayed in a different rectangle. And still the other connections in that graph are maintained. Yeah, one last thing in the demo is can regard statuses, for example. I can use any label I want, like security, and have status green. And now will happen nothing, right? And now I will have that status red. I think everybody understands what that means. And hope reload works, yeah. So now Fubile 2 has a security issue, and that is also presented in the graph. And finally, one thing I can generate is the graph. The other thing is have some rendered HTML document, which I can also turn into a PDF and send that to management or whatever. And so you have here all this, the rendered graph and all the information that's available. For example, here there's FUBAR2, and it's just in a table from where that info comes from. Yeah, that's so much for the demo. So what are my project goals? I think I already mentioned some of them. I want to have a high automation level and perhaps no installation if possible, or just Docker run and have that all the rest done for you. Because I want to have it used by developers or ops guys or whoever with a white with a blue collar is there. Because I'm a developer too. We don't have time to do that documentation stuff full time. So other thing is no fees or costs, because often in the projects you need some documentation but you don't have the money for it, and you. Of course, reuse existing sources is one of the greatest ideas in the project, I think. And yeah, you name it, whatever it is. This talk is about getting feedback from you. If you're interested in application landscape management, or you have to do it, you maybe want to have a look at Nevio and add some feature requests. The Nevio has a GitHub repo. It's bonden/Nevio. Bonden, that's me. And you maybe want to add some bugs here or feature requests or whatever you think is can help you. Yeah, so that's it basically. My plan is to get feedback from you and then have some first adopters. First of all, I would ask my friends. They owe me something and they have to install it in their environment and then maybe get more feedback. And once maybe I'm hoping or I'm dreaming that Nevio will become the most visually appealing tool, because one reason also why I built Nevio was that most rendered stuff is really ugly. So I wanted to have something cute to I can look at every day. Yeah, thank you. Yeah, any questions? I think there's plenty of time. Yeah?
So, thank you for the talk. Seems like an interesting project. As I'm currently on the Kubernetes train, or however you want to say that, I could imagine that would be quite cool to have it in Kubernetes, because you have already everything described in declarative resources and then maybe even combined with service meshes like Istio and so on, you could get some quite nice graphics out of it. And if you go further and implement GitLab or whatever, you maybe can get nearly fully automatically your full environment with security issues, with out-of-date software, and so on and so on. So also objectives that enterprise-grade software is doing already now and doing it manually most of the time. So yes, just a comment.
Yeah, thank you. I think that's true, and that's something also Linux is, I think it's okay.
It's done.
Hallo? 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 Hallo?
Okay, I think that's already something that Linux is doing, and that's why Linux is a great product. I'm just copying something of Linux, as I just can say that, because I don't want to compete with professional tools. I will never have an UI, for example, or I will never have some sophisticated authentication, but I can use some basic features too. Yeah. Any other comments?
Thank you. We saw the Docker Compose files as input plus that YAML format. We just heard about Kubernetes. Of course, there are also Kubernetes YAML files that could be used as input in theory. Are there any other formats that you either are using currently or that you are considering using? For example, I could imagine Swagger may also be interesting for different kinds of information, but also for helpful information.
Yeah, please add that to GitHub as a feature request. In fact, I have an alpha version of Kubernetes running, but I'm not the Kubernetes expert, and I did some things wrong, which I have to correct now. And of course, you can dream of a lot of things. For example, like Prometheus. Prometheus is a logging system. It basically holds a count of every system there is, and you could read that Prometheus stuff. And other formats. I don't know. Imagine something. Add them to GitHub. One thing I'd like to add to concerning Prometheus and state, service state is an important thing. I mentioned also health, and these are statuses too, as health and what else is there? Security, things like that. You can use Prometheus, for example, as a source and have don't create new services, but add some state information to services too. So there's a lot of things I want to do, but over the time. That will happen. Any more comments, questions? Okay, then that's it. Thank you for coming. And please have a look at the project and leave some comments if you wish. Thank you.